I want to tell you about a man named Howard who lives in England. Back in 2007, he was filming his two little boys playing together. He had a 56-second clip that he wanted to send to a family friend in the USA. The file was too large to send in an email, so he uploaded it to this little website called YouTube. Maybe you've heard of it. The video was only intended to be viewed by family and friends, but as one person passed it along to another, and then shared on social networks, and then reshared and reshared and reshared over and over again, it became a worldwide phenomenon. The video is called Charlie Bit Me, and today this 56-second clip has been viewed more than 500 million times.
So this begs the question, how is it possible that a video can go from a small group of people to hundreds of millions around the world? Well, it's simple. Someone's moved by it. They laugh, they tweet it, they post it, they flick it, whatever they do, and other people see it and they think to themselves, I love it. Somebody else has got to see this. They're impacted by it, they're moved by it. And before long, news spread and more people pass it along. And this sort of thing, it just can't be stopped.
Favorite viral video?
Gangnam Style.
Things like the Harlem Shake and Gangnam Style are always kind of classics. They're quite cool.
Charlie Bit Me is a good one, I think, for a viral video. It's quite a good one.
A kid after the dentist. He's still on the medication, and the dad just keeps on joking with him and making him laugh. It's really funny.
Crazy lion attacks.
This guy running around. Pretending to be Sergio Flores, an internationally touring saxophone player who only knows how to play Careless Whisper by George Michael. He does it in the most bizarre places.
I like this one of a bulldog that can't fit in a box.
Yeah, there's a Mexican dog that dances salsa.
You know, the one who's too big for the box.
Okay.
Just over 2,000 years ago, a man named Jesus stepped foot on planet Earth. He had 12 close friends that people called his disciples. Today, there are more than 2 billion Christians spread out all over the world. This is the Christian church. What used to be a small group of people in a city in the Middle East has spread and grown into an unparalleled global movement. As early Christians had a deep conviction and passion to tell others about Jesus, the good news began to spread from one person to another. People have left their jobs and homes and traveled to the other side of the world. Some have risked their lives, and millions upon millions of dollars have been invested to get the gospel to people that haven't heard. All of this because the message of Jesus is too incredible to stay in the hands of a small group of people.
Christianity is not and was never intended to be a one-man journey or a solo sport. If you flip open your Bible and read the book of Acts, you quickly discover that the very first Christians ate together, served the poor together, prayed together, worshiped together, and studied the Bible together. The picture we get of the early church is of a growing community of people celebrating together the new life that they found in Jesus.
Now I'm a preacher. A few times a week, I get to stand up in front of groups of people and talk about Jesus. It's an incredible honor, and there's really nothing I enjoy more. But there's a lot of people that don't really appreciate what I do. In fact, they don't like anyone talking about Jesus. I once heard somebody say that a quiet Christian is the best kind of Christian. Or in other words, it's okay for you to be a Christian, but don't talk to anyone else about it. And it makes me wonder, what if all Christians hid from others? Imagine if the very first Christians just blended in. We wouldn't be here today, and no one would know the good news.
100 years ago, in a dark pub in the small Scottish fishing village of Port Nocky, several men were sitting quietly drinking at tables and around the bar. Out of nowhere, in walked a man who, rather than drinking, started to tell everyone about God. The only person who showed any interest was a man called George Wood. He stood transfixed by what he heard, and he gave his life to Jesus that night. If that man had never gone into that pub, George would never have heard about God's love. But what's more, George would never have been able to then tell his children, including his son David, about Jesus. If David had never been told about Jesus, how could he then tell his own daughter Dorothy? And Dorothy is the mother of our own very lovable and very animated Jason Ballard. So if it wasn't for that man's courage in that pub all those years ago, Jason might not know how amazing Jesus truly is, or be sharing him with us today.
Now, I've never met my great-grandpa George before, or the man who told him about Jesus, but I've been thinking, what if he decided to keep his mouth closed about his faith? Then I might not know God today. Where did this deep passion to tell others come from? In Matthew 28:19, Jesus says, "Go and make disciples of all nations." This was the very last instruction he gave his disciples before he ascended to heaven. Jesus tells you and I to share the good news with others, and love compels us to do it. Love for Jesus and love for others. I remember the specific day that my friend Andrew decided to follow Jesus. And I remember the moment my friend Jared told me that he wanted to follow God. I remember this stuff because I love my friends. And there's nothing I want more than for them to begin a relationship with Jesus. Jesus saved my life and filled me with peace and joy. And I want this for all of the people that I love. Imagine being stranded on a desert island with a small group of people. If you found water, of course the loving thing to do would be to tell the rest of the group. And in the same way, we know so many people who are overwhelmed with guilt and scared of death and burdened by sin. And the gospel, the good news of Jesus, is like fresh water. To keep Jesus a secret is like hiding water from thirsty people.
There's a popular magician named Penn Jillette. He's famous for his illusion and comedy show, and he's also famous for being an outspoken atheist. He posted a clip online, and in it he talks about a guy who came up to him after one of his shows. The guy handed him a Bible and started talking to him about Jesus. Now obviously Penn didn't agree with the things he was saying, but he explained that if this guy actually believed that people who don't follow Jesus won't have everlasting life, then he'd have to be a pretty hateful person not to tell him about it. I've found that many people are open to hearing about Jesus. We always run the risk of people being bothered, but love compels us to speak boldly.
The message about Jesus is good news. And who doesn't love telling others about good news? My friend Andrew fell in love with a restaurant near his house. And the reason why he loved this particular restaurant so much is because of one dish, the spicy Thai chicken roll-up. He was nuts about it. He had the same meal more than 140 times. He used to tell anyone that would listen about it and wanted everyone around him to experience how good it was. It became a really big part of his life. I remember one time at a party, I heard him across the room telling somebody else all about it, how much it cost, where they could get it, and how good it is. Andrew found something that he loved, and like anything we love, we tell others about it.
A relationship with Jesus changes people's lives. There's nothing quite like watching this happen for someone.
112:17, take one.
Hey, my name's Joey, and I work part-time and just living life. Before I became a Christian, I was just really, really empty. I was depressed. At school, I was well known, and I was likable. And at the end of the day, I was so empty and so lonely, and so like, I just felt like there was no purpose for my life. I started hanging out with this girl and really started to like her, and she was a Christian, and I didn't know what that meant. We dated for a year and a half, and really through her parents, I just saw the way they lived, and they didn't really like preach to me a lot or like shove anything down my throat, but they were literally just like, the way they lived with such joy and such peace, and I started to really wonder, like, why are they like that? That's when I started to kind of know that there was a God, or start to question if there is a God. And really, it was towards like the end of me and my ex-girlfriend's relationship where I kind of cried out to God and was just like, you know, God, help me. Like, I don't know how to do this, but like, help me, because I'm hurting and I'm broken right now, because my life seemed to be ending, because she filled that void in my heart that I've been searching for. And losing her felt like the end of things. I could see people walking it out, and I could see the joy that people had just knowing God and walking with God. And I just knew that God was the only thing that could fill my heart. God was the only thing that would satisfy me ultimately. And sin is just so temporary. When God came into my life, everything changed. To know that like God has a plan for me, like change my life. That was probably one of the biggest things, because I was so lost, without a hope and without purpose in my life. People need to have hope, and people want God. They don't know it, but they really do. They need God, and what they're searching for is God, and I can trust in Him, and He's gonna lead the way, and He's got amazing plans for me. So that's radically changed my life. So.
Yeah, it has to be okay to tell people about Jesus. If what we believe about Jesus is true, it's the most important news that anybody will ever receive.
Whenever you're excited about something, or you're in love with your job, or you're going to tell others about it. So when you love Jesus, you share what's inside of you, and yeah.
I think it'd be wrong not to go and do what you believe.
If you're sharing your opinion with the expectation to change other people's minds, then maybe it's not the best intentions.
I don't really like it when people try to shove it in your face, and, you know, say if you don't believe in this, then you're gonna go to hell or something. I don't think that's fair.
No.
That's not for you to judge.
I'm not being those people yelling at them on the corners, but being nice.
You're not gonna change someone who isn't willing, but I think it's okay if the person's okay with it.
When you think of church, what comes to mind? Maybe it's pastors or priests, choirs, cathedrals, buildings, and stained glass windows. While these things are connected to the church isn't limited to them. It's something even more dynamic and alive and beautiful. The Bible describes the Christian church as the people of God. That's every follower of Jesus in every country in the world. We're the family of God.
Okay, so imagine with me that we're going for a drive. I pick you up in my awesome blue car. We turn on the radio and we're just cruising, having a good time driving, going to all the best spots in town, past the beach, down the main drag. And then you say, Jay, I'd love to see your family. I think that's a great idea. So we pull up in front of my family and there it is, check it out. Did you notice the nice red door on my family? How about that roof? I installed it last summer on my family. I love the lawn in front of my family. The springtime does wonders to it, but this is my favorite part. We just installed these last week. They're energy efficient, environmentally friendly windows. It's a really great addition to my family. At this point in time, you're probably thinking, Jason, you told me you're gonna show me your family. You know that's your house, right? And in the same way, the Christian church is a group of people, not a building. In Ephesians chapter 2, it says that the church is a building built out of people. And Jesus is the chief cornerstone, the part that holds it all together.
It's amazing to think about the impact that Jesus has had on the world.
Yeah, nearly one third of the world is part of the church. There was a study done just over 100 years ago that showed that there were 10 million Christians in Africa. The same study done 100 years later revealed that the number had grown to 360 million.
The church is growing incredibly fast, even though there are Christians being persecuted in over 60 nations around the world today. Christians are abused verbally, socially, politically, and sometimes physically. People are beaten, church buildings burned down, and in some cases, people are murdered for following Jesus. The amazing thing is, in spite of all of this, the church is still growing and faster than ever before.
In Ephesians chapter 1, it says that when you become a Christian, you're adopted into God's family. That makes us sons and daughters and brothers and sisters. This is so exciting. We're all unified because we have one heavenly Father.
And even though there are many things that separate Christians into denominations and groups, the things that unite us are much bigger and far more important. Ephesians 4 says that the Holy Spirit unites the church together as one big family.
I remember growing up, my brother Kevin and I used to get in fights all the time, like all brothers do. He'd be watching TV, maybe his favorite show, and I'd snatch the remote control and change the channel, and he would tweak out, start calling me names and be like, you're stupid, you're dumb. And then I'd be like, no, Kevin, you're stupid, you're dumb. And then we'd just fight. But then it'd be like moments later, and he'd be like, hey man, you want some chocolate milk? I'd be like, yeah, that sounds awesome.
Thank you.
I love that about family. Even though sometimes you get in disagreements, you stick together. Now, I know my family isn't perfect, and neither is the family of God, but we're family. And even if sometimes we don't always get along or agree on everything, we stick together by the power of the Holy Spirit.
In John 17, Jesus prays that as the family of God, we would be united as one. In John 13, he said that the world would be changed by our love for one another. The Bible also says that the church is the body of Christ. We each play a part, and each part fits into the whole. The eye can't say to the hand that it doesn't need it, and the foot can't say to a finger that it doesn't matter. Every part matters. Becoming a Christian doesn't mean I have to just become like everybody else. We each have an important and unique part to play. God uses the church to be His hands and feet on the earth. We work with Him to bring about His will in our schools and communities.
One night I was sitting in front of McDonald's with some friends eating dinner, and we noticed that there's a guy in the corner of the parking lot standing by himself. He ended up walking up to us and asked if he could use my phone. His name was Carl, he's from out of town, he was really drunk and he seemed lost. All that he knew was that his girlfriend was staying at some hotel in the area. So we decided we should help this guy. Carl jumped in our car and we went to every single hotel around that we could think of. And while we were driving, he began to tell us a bit about his life. He never knew his mom and dad. He grew up going to different orphanages and foster homes where he was abused and taken advantage of. He explained that before we met him that night in the McDonald's parking lot, he had asked God to help him out. We told him that we were Christians and that we believed that God had set the whole night up. After almost an hour of driving around town and stopping at more than 5 hotels, we finally found his girlfriend. And I was surprised how excited my friends and I were to find her. I remember he cried and I cried and we all hugged. And as we drove away that night, we had this overwhelming sense that we are part of God's plan. We got to be the body of Christ to Carl. We got to be God's hands and feet.
Throughout history, the church has led the way in responding to the needs around the world, providing education, caring for widows and orphans, giving food and clean water to the hungry. This is God's will for His church, and we're part of that as followers of Jesus.
There's no doubt that for the very first Christians, meeting together as members of the church was incredibly important. They would gather all the time to pray and to worship and to study the Word. They would encourage one another and care for those in need. The book of Hebrews challenges us to continue to meet together as followers of Christ, and to do it often.
If it helps you and that's what you believe in, then that's fine.
I can see how other people find it good, but I don't feel I need it in my life at the moment.
Iron sharpens iron, steel sharpens steel. You know, you need to be in community and communion and fellowship with fellow believers so that you go strong in your faith.
I think there are a lot of people who get a lot of value out of being in a church.
It's somewhere that people are on the same path as you, so you're walking and meeting and greeting with people that are doing the same thing as you.
Sure, for a lot of people, yes, but for me, no, not really.
I think membership is, it's not explicitly in the Bible, but I think it's, you know, implicitly implied that you should be plugged into a community of faith.
We're made for community. And gathering as the church is a necessary step to keep your relationship with God alive.
It's a privilege to gather together with other Christians. Come and be a part of the church and a youth group. And don't just show up. Commit, get involved, be the church. There are people in your life who would love the opportunity to talk about some of the things we've talked about. Invite someone to Alpha and tell others the story about Jesus, the man who is God.
And pray for your friends. Pray that they would meet Jesus. Ask God to give you the words to say at just the right time and the ability to listen in a whole new way. Live your life as an example of someone who's loved by God and is learning to love others more.
So this is it. We've come to the end of our time together. In the first episode, we said that we wanted to be your tour guides on this journey. The last 11 sessions have been a lot of fun, and it's been our privilege to be along for the ride.
Yeah, we've talked about some of life's greatest questions. Questions about life, faith in God. And here's the thing,
This is just the beginning. The journey has just begun. Following Jesus is life's great adventure.